Hello everybody, happy new year, happy Christmas. It's probably a bit late to say that, but happy Christmas anyway, and happy new year. 2023 is upon us, and I thought, what no better way is there than to start the year with an organ recital, an Epiphany organ recital, with a few pieces in tonight's programme very relevant for the season of Epiphany, including the very first one. So tonight you're going to have all sorts of wonderful music. You can look in the description for a playlist. You can also look in the description for a track timestamp. So you can zoom on to your favourite piece of music if you want to skip something. Please do say hello in the live chat, plus one and your location if you're watching live. If you're watching on catch up, please leave me a comment. Say hello, how are you doing? And I'll say, I'm fine, how are you? And I'll say that back to you. I'll try. So, the first piece, I'm going to play the first two pieces back to back. It is Maurice Duruflé's Prelude sur l'introit de l'Epiphanie, Prelude on the introit for Epiphany. And the text to this, by the way, is Ecce Adventit Dominator Dominus. It translates to, Behold, the Lord, the ruler is come, and the kingdom is in his hands and power. I'm then going to go straight into J.S. Bach's monumental Prelude and Fugue in E minor, which has become nicknamed the Wedge, simply because of the shape, the musical shape of the subject of the fugue. So I'll play these two pieces back to back. So let's start with Duruflé, and we'll get straight into Bach. Very good evening to you, and I can't wait to spend the next hour or so in your company.
Thank you.
15 minutes later after that. It's the fugue, I think, is the longest fugue, for the organ at least, that Bach wrote. If you can come up with a longer fugue, then I'll give you a point, but I think that's the longest fugue. And what a fugue it is as well. It's very, how do you say, harpsichordal. It's like a very harpsichord in style. Can't quite think of the way to use that word. With all of those runs. It's unlike anything else that he wrote. It's actually, you need to really work out those fingerings. So it's called the wedge because the fugue, gradually, the intervals get bigger until you get to the octave there. So what a piece that is. We're going to stick in this sort of classical baroque style, and we're going to go into some Mendelssohn now, into his fifth organ sonata. Now it starts with a chorale, but no one seems to know what the chorale is. So we can all assume, we can only assume, that it's an original chorale written by Mendelssohn himself. It's in three movements, starts with the chorale, then goes into a beautiful sort of B minor movement, which I've played quite a lot actually during communion and before a service. It works really well. And then goes into a little bit of a sort of a flourish, very pianistic, with lots of arpeggios and that sort of writing. So it's in D major and it's sonata number 5. Just thinking about, I haven't got anyone to do the angles yet, so you're a little bit stuck with angles, so bear with me.
Thank you.
I think that's a really cool piece, actually. And if truth be told, I've never heard anyone else play that ever in my life. Apart from on various recordings, I've never heard anyone play it for a voluntary. Never seen it in a recital. Have you ever played that in a recital or for a voluntary? I think it's quite exposed, isn't it? That last section. It's a bit, you've got to be brave to play it. Or foolish. Thank you for your applause. That's very kind. Hope you're enjoying the show so far. I think it's going all right so far. Apart from I just got myself into a little bit of a muddle in the first, in the Bach, in the Prelude. Couldn't work out where the advance button was. I was trying to hit it and I was sort of like pressing the swell pedal and no, that doesn't feel right. And then I thought, oh no, now I'm on grade one, which is next to the advance. So then I played a few wrong notes in the Prelude. But apart from that, I think we're going okay so far. Phew, right. I shouldn't have said that. We're going to go into some Buxtehude now. Dietrich Buxtehude, of course, the great figure from Germany to whom Bach looked up and made the famous trek to see him and hear him play. I'm going to play the chorale prelude on Wie schön leuchtet der Morgenstern. How brightly shines the morning star. It's BuxWV 223. Now, the great thing about these chorale preludes, and indeed music by Buxtehude in general, is the interpretation of his music is open to more personal idiosyncrasies, I guess, than Bach. I think with Bach, it's you know, we have the plenum, which we use for his preludes and for his fugues. But for Buxtehude, it's a little bit different. The texture's different. The way he scores for manuals and pedals and the distribution of notes, it feels very different to play than Bach. So I hope you enjoy, or I hope you agree with my own interpretation of the registration for this piece. So it's Wie schön leuchtet der Morgenstern by Dietrich Buxtehude. someone just said in the chat, who was it? It was Ian who said that this piece benefits from a generous acoustic. And Buxtehude would have had a lovely acoustic. And you can tell because the sections, there are lots of rests in the music, which he really plays into. Isn't there like Anton Bruckner's motets where you'll have for choir, where the choir will crescendo up to a big loud chord, suddenly stop, the acoustic will then die away, you'll have a bar, a rest with a pause mark on it, and then the choir come back in like Christus Factus Est on the last page. It's the same in Buxtehude. You know, he was really writing the acoustic into the music. So you're absolutely right there, Ian. Right, so on to the main event now, the Healy Willan Introduction, Passacaglia and Fugue in E flat minor. Oh, what a key. What a key. C flat, double flats, it goes all over the place, this. So this is the last piece you want to be playing after you've had a couple of glasses of wine. I haven't. All I've got here is some blueberries, which I don't know whether they're alcoholic or not. Anyway, so Healy Willan, did you know, was actually born in England, spent his time in around London, around Eastbourne, I think, before emigrating out to Toronto in 1913. He became the organist at St. Paul's on Bloor Street in Toronto, and then composed this, this epic piece in 1916. So obviously he was inspired by the organ. Interestingly though, it was dedicated to Walter Alcock. Walter Alcock, some of you will know, would have been at the time the organist at Salisbury Cathedral here in England. So even though he composed it whilst out in Canada, he probably started to conceive it whilst he was back in England, possibly. He actually finished it in Canada, but dedicated it to another Englishman. So this piece really does go around the houses in terms of key, in terms of registration, tempo and rhythm and everything. It's got absolutely everything, this piece. And I would say it's one of my very favourite organ pieces. And I would go as far to say that it is one of the greatest organ pieces ever written outside of Bach. One of the greatest modern pieces written. I put it up there with the Reubke. I put it up there with the Liszt, Ad Nos, with pieces by Duruflé. I think it's really fab. It's 15 minutes, so I hope you're sitting comfortably. Hope you've got your drink, and I really hope that you enjoy this performance. It starts very quietly. I always remember as a chorister hearing this in the church where I was in Chesterfield, and the very opening of it, it just reminded me of like a haunted house. You'll see what I mean. Let's get on with it. Introduction, Passacaglia and Fugue. Well, what a piece. You might think that marks the end of the recital, which normally you'd be right. But as you may have noticed, during the piece, the camera was changing angles, so we have another person in the room. Which means, rather luckily, we can actually play our duet. So what an epic piece that Willan is. It really is one of my absolute favourite pieces. And I think this organ of Blackburn does it extremely well. And I can tell you now, I know I've seen John in the chat, that registration at the end, full organ with the chamards, would have absolutely blown your ears off in the real building.
Well, somebody asked if there would be enough wind pressure for this registration.
It's rock solid, and it just is astonishing. I think it was John was saying that when the BBC were there a few weeks ago, one of the sound engineers, the technician, said
it was illegal.
The sound levels can't be right.
That's what he said in the chat just now.
Right, let's go on to this now. This the Marche. How do you say that in French?
Marche des Rois Mages, I presume.
March of the Magi Kings. By Thibaut Dubois.
Can I just ask a question before we start? Because I haven't practiced. Am I on the solo manual up here? Top one, top manual.
That one. Yeah. You have to play one note.
And
you've got one thing to do.
Onctave is tremulant. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
So I have. This organ has lots of tremulants. So it's quite a tremulant on the swell, on the great, on the choir, and I only have three tremulant stops. So we're having to use this octave. Stop head as the tremulant on the solo. I'll have to commission another tremulant.
Can't get the equipment these days.
Here we go. So let's follow the star, and let's have a bit of a trek with the Magi Kings as they're going to see the baby Jesus, to meet him with the gold and the frankincense
and myrrh.
Don't worry, there's myrrh. Get it? Don't worry.
Yes, got it now.
Here you go, you got gold and frankincense. But don't worry, there's myrrh. More. Oh, forget it. Right, here we go. Let's go on to the Dubois. What angle should we go for?
I think the top. Everything.
Everything. That one.
Thank you.
There we go. I think the Magi have arrived safely by the crib. I wonder, you know, this bit in the middle. What is this? Is this thunder in the difference in the distance? Ooh, thunder. Well, thunder's normally quite low, isn't it? That's the point. It's not right up there. The weird thunder, if it was. I think that's thunder rolling. Because how far do these guys walk? Well, they've got the camels, haven't they?
Nearly as far as Bach walked to see Buxtehude.
No one's walked as far as Bach to see Buxtehude. So there we go. I think that
Elizabeth asked, does the high note represent the star? Yes, it does.
Well, it does. Who is that?
Elizabeth. Chat's moved on. I think it was Elizabeth someone.
Yes, it does. I should have said at the beginning. So the star at the very beginning, which is plonked down, is the star. And actually he says on the bottom of the page, this note must be sustained from the measure, from the beginning to the end. It is essential, blah, 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 blah. Where is it?
It says, to the harmony throughout.
The key may be held by a second person or by a weight. So, you know, a pencil or a, I don't know, what.
These cats aren't heavy enough. They're not heavy enough, look.
Can I just finish what I'm saying? Choose the tremulant from time to time. So, why does he use the tremulant from time to time? I wonder. They're starting to wave, you know. Is it foggy? I can't see the star.
We should have used this.
Have they had a bit of... Yes, I should have done. But it's not. It isn't not in the right key. So, yeah, why use the tremulant? That is the question. What was Dubois? In fact, I was going to use the tremulant. Yeah, the symbol show. And, you know, the Willan. I forgot to add it on. Oh, what's a shame. Oh, well, they wouldn't have heard it anyway because it was so loud. The organ's so loud. Okay, so there we go. That brings a close to the recital, the Epiphany recital. I hope it was Epiphany enough for you. And thank you very much for joining me. Thank you for your virtual honesty tickets tonight. That's very kind of you. It's wonderful to get back into the routine of playing Saturday recitals online. As you can expect, lots of recitals will be coming throughout the year on Saturdays, some of which will be given by me, some of which will be given by other people.
Not me.
You never know.
April 1st.
If ever April 1st is on a Saturday, then it's over to you, my friend. So we're really looking forward to spending the year with you. It's going to be a fab year. Lots in store. I can really sense that this year is going to be a really good year for online organ music. So you've got to stay tuned.
Have you said what's happening tomorrow in virtual church?
Oh, no, I haven't. Thank you for reminding me. Tomorrow, virtual church, we have... They're not in here. We have 5 copies of Call for Composers to give away.
We had a Christmas giveaway.
Yes, we had a Christmas giveaway. A very generous member of our community has donated 5 copies of the Call for Composers. We've had quite a few people who came forwards wanting one. And we've had to choose 5 of those people.
It wasn't very easy. A lot of people wrote very well about why they deserved one. And they were very deserving, but we could only choose 5, unfortunately. But we have chosen 5.
Which will be announced tomorrow at Virtual Church. Usual time at 8:00. Maurice, I never saw nothing about no honesty ticket. How many negatives have I got in there? Anyway, it's just a thing. It's just a thing. You know, if you like something that I've done, give me a fiver, if you want. Dear. Right, let's call it a night there now. It's 9:20. So until tomorrow, we will say cheerio. Good night, everyone.
Cheerio.
Take care, stay safe, and Happy New Year to you all. By the way, Christmas tree will be down soon, as will the decorations up here. Sad times. I'd rather leave them up, if I'm honest. I quite like them. But they will come down at some point, maybe for next weekend. Good night.